depending on how you experience Mr. Self-Destruct, Piggy could feel like a welcome relief. Especially at the beginning, the drum groove is so minimal. In direct opposition to Mr. Self-Destruct, Piggy does not come at you fast. In fact, you have ample, if not sometimes too much time, to prepare for what's going to come next. The energy level has fallen significantly, and the tempo is almost painfully slow at 66 beats per minute. It kind of feels like the life has been sucked out of you. The kick only falls on the first beat of every measure, and the measures are pretty slow, which leaves this sort of hollow feeling in the rest of the drum groove. It reminds me kind of somebody trudging along, like each step is laborious. Nothing can stop me now because I don't care anymore. I feel like that kind of embodies like what this song is supposed to feel like. There's really nothing left to lose. And so there's almost this like empowerment that comes from that. Now you'll hear that the drums and the bass start to swing rhythmically during the chorus. What I mean by swinging is that normally 16th notes are subdivided equally. They have the same duration. But when something's swinging, the first note is longer and the second note is shorter. This is a much more natural rhythm. We normally don't speak like this. We have emphasis on certain words, and some are longer and some are shorter. So anytime you have this type of syncopation, this swing, the groove, the song just feels more relatable. So as usual, it's difficult for me to pinpoint exactly what key we're in, but we're in B. I'm getting some really strong Phrygian mode vibes in the bass line. Nothing can stop me now, 'cause I don't care anymore. Nothing can stop me now, 'cause I just don't care. But then in the vocal melody, oftentimes he's resolving to the major third. And he has a lot of sus fours resolving to major threes. Nothing can stop me now. But as always, he's a little bit ambiguous with his third. Sometimes it sounds like a raised third. Sometimes it sounds like a lowered third. It really just kind of depends. Hey, pig. Hey, pig. Hey, pig! So if I were to try to play the melody on the keyboard, I'd have to make a choice, and it would be a difficult one. Now, there is a mode called Phrygian Dominant that has both the flat two of Phrygian and the raised third of a lot of the other modes. But the bass line doesn't play the major third, it plays the minor third. So we also have a raised sixth, which isn't in Phrygian or in minor. So as usual, we kind of have like a modal interchange or some kind of cross-modalization going on. I just made that up. So these are the notes we're working with. This is one, flat seven, flat two, and the flat three. When you have a flat two, it kind of brings things down. It makes things darker. It's even more dark than the major second that is in the minor scale. He does this a lot more, I think, later on in his career, where he has sort of a 3/2 rhythm, and then at the end of the phrase, he just sort of squares things off. Let's talk about the chord progression in the verse, because it actually sounds like more of a common chord progression than we're used to hearing. There are a couple different interpretations for what it is, so here's option one. With a diminished sixth chord, or you. That second one might sound more satisfying to you, and there's a reason for that. This diminished sixth chord doesn't have a lot of power or a very strong function. But the major four, that definitely feels satisfying when it resolves back up to one. If it were that four chord, it would have to be an inverted chord because the bass line goes down to the G sharp with the third underneath it. But regardless, what's happening in the bass line is there's not a lot of movement. Almost like it's kind of lazy. And I don't mean that compositionally, I mean emotionally. To illustrate my point to you, I'm going to play the chord progression, but modify that sixth chord, that diminished sixth chord, to a flat major sixth chord, which is a bigger, bolder, more open progression. Hey, pig. Yeah, you. Hear how like dramatic that is compared to, but these are all guesses because he's not really giving us any more information. In the remix on Further Down the Spiral, we have a completely different chord progression, which is a major 1-4-7-4. Hey, pig. Yeah, you. So that means that 4 is definitely a chord that was kind of on his mind. The organ does give us a little bit more of a taste, but it still doesn't give us everything. Trent likes to make us work for it, and I've heard him say that exact thing, so it's true. So here's what it sounds like the organ is doing, which is really nice, actually. Okay, so in the second verse, when the organ comes in, he does change the chord progression to the flat six. Bravo, Mr. Reznor. I want to turn my attention to his vocals, both just the melodies and the repetitions and also his performance. I'm going to play a surround sound mix isolated track for you, or channel. It's really interesting because it sounds like the way they recorded it is that the engineer didn't cut out his breaths, didn't really do anything between these phrases, which are really far apart. You know, hey, pig. There's so much dead space. And they just left it all in. Listen to the sounds of him inhaling, sniffing.
Hey, pig. Yeah, you. Hey, pig, piggy, pig, pig, pig. All of my fears came true. And blue and broken bones, you left me here, I'm all alone. My little piggy needed something new.
I like to think that even though we may not be aware of this unless we isolate it, that it still affects us subliminally. Hearing his breath is like a signal to how close we are to someone that we only know one thing about right now, which is that he's being tormented by all of his bad parts.
Hey, pig, there's a lot of things I hoped you could help me understand.
Reminds me of someone like keeping it together, acting really casual, but underneath it, they're about to explode. Sort of oscillating between like loving and contemptuous and like chill, but also like holding in a lot of anger, sometimes even like taunting or mocking tones, which to me sort of conjures up this feeling that he's still like really kind of torn. There are lots of parts of him, lots of conflicting feelings going on. One second he feels care for Piggy, and another second he feels hatred. He's also not singing particularly well or in tune. His voice is cracking a lot. He's kind of wavering, but he's okay with all of this. He doesn't want it to sound like a great vocal performance. He wants it to sound raw. Anytime you repeat something, you're going to be adding a level of predictability for your listener, something that they can look forward to and expect. Obviously, he's starting most of his phrases with some variation of, Hey, Pig. So I really like that he kind of changes it every time, just a little bit for the most part. At first, he's singing Hey, Pig on the eighth notes, then Hey, Pig, Piggy, Pig, 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 and then eventually Hey, Pig on the quarter notes. Keeps it interesting, but still gives us something to hold on to. But I probably don't have to tell you that the pig and swine is a really important symbol in this album. Now, before we go further down the spiral, I just want to mention a few things that may have gone unnoticed. When he sings Black and Blue and Broken Bones, You Left Me Here, I'm All Alone, you hear what sounds like a car horn. Kind of like have this picture of like a man who's been beaten down and he's like, yeah, lost everything. And he's like stumbling on the sidewalk and then he sort of trips into the street and is sort of just walking in the street. And then somebody just leans on the horn, you know? But he doesn't care anymore. Nothing can stop him now. He just keeps walking. Ooh, here's another really cool buried layer is this sort of, it's like a really simple melody that's created by a sample of something that's been time stretched, I think, and then pitched at different pitches. I'm really not sure where this sample comes from, or maybe it's two samples. And this is Signature Trent, and not just because of the sound design. Trent uses these particular scale degrees very frequently. The distance between these notes is a tritone. Now I'm really curious if y'all have heard this before, because I really didn't. And that's a sample of screaming. It sounds almost more like someone's at an amusement park, or they're at a fair. And it kind of swells in at the beginning of every measure, sort of coinciding with that kick drum.
There's a lot of things I hoped you could help me understand.
I'm not saying that he was intentionally trying to bury it, but I do think it acts mostly subliminally on a lot of listeners. It puts us in a state of unease. It also feels like a really weird contrast because that's just not the type of screaming maybe. I mean, I wouldn't even expect any screaming with this song, but much less like, sounds like kids having fun screaming. Interesting side note, when you listen to the live version on All That Could Have Been, the crowd is screaming right away and it sounds like it is right where it belongs. The tambourine in this song is very consistent and swinging. It's doing its job, it's keeping time really well, but something weird happens right when he's singing Lost My Shit Because of You. It falters in this really sort of sad, stumbling way, and it doesn't recover. I know this is a really small detail, but it's something that I always look forward to when I hear this song. I just love that part, and I know it was intentional because you can hear it in all of the live performances too. I just really appreciate musicians that have that level of attention to detail. There's just such a payoff. Like, if they didn't do that, I would be like, what? I've been robbed. And of course, this is combined with this sort of screeching guitar that comes in atonally. He definitely sounds like he's lost a little bit of his cool. Lost my shit because of you. I'm fine.
What am I supposed to do?
So I just think it's really cool that he used the tambourine, which is such a, I don't know, it's like kind of an innocent sounding instrument, although I think he may have corrupted the tambourine for a lot of people forever. But to have it kind of fall apart with everything else is just some really nice, like, lyric painting. Another cool thing that happens when he sings Lost My Shit Because of You is that we get missing measures. We prematurely go to the chorus. In the first chorus, the phrasing is even, meaning it's a multiple of four. There are eight measures to a phrase. In the second verse, it's just six measures for the phrase. Combined with all the things I just mentioned, it's just, I want to isolate a channel for you. So this part is during the outro, so you also get to hear some of the percussion. I I just wanted to play that for you because I have to say, I really, really like that. Okay, so we're moving into the part of the analysis where we're gonna talk about the outro, which I have to say is my favorite part of the song. When I first got the downward spiral, I just didn't have the patience for songs that didn't immediately grab me. And this one just didn't, so I just skipped it every single time. I don't even know how many years went by until I finally listened to Piggy all the way through. And I remember though being like, oh, this is super cool. I've been missing out. The harmonic movement in the outro is quite different than the rest of the song. As I mentioned, things are kind of staying in a very small range for the verse and chorus, but during the outro, they really spread out and it's really bold and really noticeable. So the outro just automatically sounds bigger. It sounds brighter. What's so cool about this bass line and this implied harmonic movement is that it would have been really easy to stick with the Phrygian theme and to have a flat 2, for example. And that would have made so much sense, but he intentionally raises that 2 up to... That major second actually feels so much more bolder and brighter, similarly to how that flat major six does. When there's more space between intervals, they just tend to sound more open. So there are two other things that I really missed out on when I didn't listen to the whole track when I was younger. And that is the drum chaos and the beautiful melody that comes in at the very end to close out the song. I really like this drum section because it sounds like somebody, maybe the protagonist, falling over themselves, stumbling around, tripping, for just a second, actually hitting some sort of normal stride, and then tripping again. I read, I think, on the Nine Inch Nails wiki that Trent is actually the one drumming in this section, and it was supposed to be some sort of filler for a real drum solo, but they ended up just keeping it. And it sounds to me like they recorded him drumming, he sampled it and chopped it up and rearranged things. Sure, there are some longer sections where things aren't spliced together so tightly, but there's plenty of times where it's just one shot, and then another one shot, another one shot. And it's supposed to sound broken and weird. And I think what makes it so compelling is that sometimes it does sound right. So it's just that experience of, like, again, trying to find your footing, you get it, you lose it. And the way we enter this section is so satisfying too. Let me just get this tambourine by itself and these hits. And those are eighth note triplets. The eighth note triplets come back at probably my favorite part of this drum solo. Melody is so beautiful, and to me it is like the foreshadowing of what I consider the downward spiral melodic theme, which you hear at the end of Closer, and what the whole song, The Downward Spiral, is based off of. It's not necessarily the notes themselves, although there are some similar notes. It's really the synth lead itself, the actual sound of this synth patch, and the way they're sort of played like little droplets falling into a puddle. It starts on the seventh and resolves down to the third. That tritone. Because we end here and then we go back up to the seventh to start over, you get this tritone relationship, which is a really hallmark sound of Nine Inch Nails. He loves that sus4 resolving to the major third. It's like the major third softens the landing.
Doesn't it make you feel better?
And that's all we're left with. Thank you for watching Piggies, and I'll see you next week for Heresy.